Hi, everyone. I want to welcome you to what we think will be a really great panel on the future of sports. And we have two very interesting and two very different perspectives on LA sports. And first, we're very excited to have LA's newest sports team, new as of about last week. Julie Ehrman is founder and president of WFC LA Angel City. That is the new pro women's soccer team that will start playing in LA in 2022, when hopefully everything will be back to normal. Backers of that team include a lot of interesting people: Natalie Portman, Serena Williams, and her husband, Alexis Ohanian, as well as Upfront's Karen Norman. And previously, Ehrman was head of media at Playboy, founder and CEO of the gaming company Ouya, and Lionsgate's GM of Over the Top Ventures. So thank you so much for joining us, Julie, and welcome to LA, to the team. And we're also very pleased to be joined by Kevin Demoff. He's in his 11th year as chief operating officer of the Los Angeles Rams, and he was part of the group that returned to the Rams to LA in 2016. He's also played a key role in developing SoFi Stadium and the surrounding 300-acre sports and entertainment district in Inglewood that will surround it. So welcome to you both.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. Well, before we get to a little bit of the far-off future and some of the tech stuff, I want to start with the immediate future. Julie, you're fortunate to have a little bit more time before you guys start playing. But Kevin, the Rams started training camp this week. They are scheduled to host the Cowboys on September 13th in the new stadium on Sunday Night Football. The NFL is not using any sort of bubble. So Kevin, how likely do you think at this point that game happens and the rest of the season can be played?
Already on mute, go figure. I think we're all very encouraged the fact that the players have come back throughout the league, and you know, we've all probably expected the worst in terms of number of positive tests. And while we've had some, I think the percentages have been much lower than those in the general population. So I think there's excitement that once we get going, you know, hopefully we can keep it moving. And I think if you look at the other sports, the success of basketball and hockey so far, the NBA and the NHL, it's exciting. Obviously, baseball has gone through some different challenges, which is a little bit more applicable to us, given that we're not in a bubble, unlike the other sports. I think one of the things, if you're studying baseball, though, right now, is it does seem that the outbreak is team by team and not league spread, which I think is something we can study over the next 5 to 6 weeks. And hopefully our players can learn from those protocols. And seemingly it's coming from teams that are traveling on the road. And I think that's something great that we can all study to understand how do we tighten up those restrictions when we travel. We're a little bit easier in the sense that we fly into the city a night before and leave right after the game. So there's a little bit less, you know, free time in the city, you know, as it pertains to that. But, you know, boy, are we excited to try to get into SoFi Stadium to open that building up September 13th against the Dallas Cowboys on Sunday Night Football. What a great monument for the Rams and for the city of Los Angeles that would be.
And we're excited to get there. Do you think that fans will be able to be in the stands this season? Are you making any plans for that?
You know, I think probably like everybody in every business, we're making multiple contingency plans. So we have formats for no fans. We have formats for 15,000 fans, which seems the most likely right now, given, you know, CDC and local regulations. If we're allowed to have fans, we're making plans for 50% full. And then ultimately we've always planned for, you know, 100% full. And so I think you have to be somewhat flexible as you sit right now. I think if you listen to scientists everywhere, the virus controls the path, and then the public controls the path. And I think one of the best things we've heard throughout the past month that, you know, sports are the benefit of a well-functioning society. And we've got to get back to that point from a public health standpoint where people not only are excited to come to games again, but feel safe doing so.
You mentioned baseball, though, and that season seems to be teetering on the brink. And football has a lot closer contact than baseball. And, you know, there was the CBA came out today, or at least the draft version of it, that has, you know, pretty strict rules for players. What are some of the steps that you're going to be taking to make sure that players stay safe?
Well, look, first and foremost, those rules are not just for players. They're for staff, they're for coaches, they're for everybody in the organization, right? And the one thing we're preaching to to all 200 people in our building, is this is not just the player's responsibility. Anybody who, a trainer, the equipment staff, your scouting staff, anybody in the front office, anybody who comes into contact with players, it's your responsibility as well to make sure that you're abiding by those things. And you don't want to be the person who goes out to a bar or an event and catches the virus and gives it to Jared Goff, right? That just, ultimately, we all carry a sense of personal responsibility, you know, from that. They are strict. I do think they need to be if we're going to be able to play, because it needs to be the sense of giving players that safety that they want to come to work and be their best. And it is hard. You can't socially distance playing football. But if you do everything else right, and we test daily like we're doing now, or, you know, every other day as it may go to during the season, you should be able to do the things we all talk about as a society. Frequent testing, contact tracing, social distancing, wearing masks, and hope that that works. And I think if you, we can't create our own bubble, but you can create, you know, a fairly effective system to find anybody who might be, you know, asymptomatic and spreading the virus, and make sure you quarantine them quickly and then isolate those they're in contact with.
Well, I want to hear more about this stadium a little later, but, you know, you are sort of Stan Kroenke's right-hand man here in LA, the Rams owner. And I'm just curious, you know, talking to him, how he feels right now, and, you know, does he have any regrets about spending $5 billion to build this massive stadium and surrounding complex that is all about hosting huge, huge crowds of people, something that we're not going to be able to do for a while?
I think first and foremost, there are a lot of us who play the right-hand role in helping this done, whether it's Jason Gannon or Alan Bornstein or Otto Malley. There are a lot of people who have helped make Stan's vision come to reality, and we can't wait to open it up next month. And absolutely no regrets about opening this building. It's not when we started this project and broke ground of October 2016. I don't think any of us envisioned opening the building in a pandemic. And you hope it's not to come that way. But I think of this building, you know, we're talking about the future of sports, you know, on this broadcast. And that's what this building is, whether it's hosting the 2022 Super Bowl, which will be the largest tourism event in Southern California since the 1984 Olympics, or the 2023 college football playoff, the 2026 World Cup, you know, the 2028 opening and closing ceremonies of the Olympics. This building is going to host the world's greatest events for decades to come. And it's what's been missing in LA's landscape, period. When you think about the large events that haven't been in Los Angeles, and you think about the Super Bowl has not been in the entertainment capital of the world since 1993. I mean, it's going to be 30 years. It'll been in Detroit, in Jacksonville, in all of these other smaller cities. When you think about what city should be hosting the Super Bowl, Los Angeles should be there. And I think our building is a testament to what we think the future of sports is in Los Angeles, how confident we are in this landscape. It is competitive, and you have to build an expensive building that's going to last the test of time, that's going to meet the needs and the desires of Angelenos. And I think that's exactly what we've done.
Well, Julie, I want to turn to you, and the National Women's Soccer League.
I really don't want you to. I want you to come ask on, Kevin no. questions, because I'm learning so much, and it's super fascinating.
It yeah. is, and you're welcome to you know, ask Kevin questions as well. But you know, I think the women's national the National Women's Soccer League was actually the first league to return to the United States in June, and it was quite successful. Do you guys have any tips for the NFL?
I mean, the ownership group did an incredible job with the leadership of Lisa Beard, who's the commissioner. You know, the first thing they did, which was so impactful, was tell the players, regardless if they played, they were going to get paid. And I think it showed a real commitment to the players and giving them the ability to make the right personal choices for them as it relates to health and safety and just the timing and the lead up. The timing and the lead up to you know, playing in, you know, from June to July. Sorry, I do this. She'll stop barking. There we go. That was certainly amazing. And then as it relates to the competition, I mean, they had a lot of firsts. I mean, certainly being the first professional sports team back, they created an environment where there were no positive COVID tests since everyone got into the bubble in Salt Lake City. And the other thing that was really miraculous is they brought on four additional sponsors throughout the NWSL Challenge Cup. So Secret, Procter & Gamble, Verizon, and Google all became sponsors of the NWSL specifically for this tournament, hopefully continuing through. So yes, I'm sure the NWSL has incredible advice to give the other teams, and they should all be reaching out to Lisa Baer to ask how they did it, because they did a really exceptional job in a very short period of time understanding that there are less people and, you know, less number of players and support staff, but still they created a really safe environment.
Were they able to pick up sponsors just because there were a lot of other events and sporting events happening?
I don't think it's easy to pick up sponsors in any environment. I think it's always challenging to ask brands for money. And certainly during a time of COVID when their marketing dollars are not getting spent the way that they anticipated, or they're pulling back marketing dollars because the world has changed and people's behavior has changed. I actually think it was probably the most challenging environment ever to bring on sponsors. So the fact that they brought on, you know, four in an incredibly short period of time is a real testament. So I think the strength of the NWSL and the future of NWSL and just how incredible these players are, and knowing that people are going to show up on CBS and CBS All Access and Twitch to watch these players play. So it was really positive.
Yeah, you guys recently signed a $4.5 million rights deal for CBS and Twitch. So great to see that. And, you know, it's amazing to me, though, that this league has been around for more than a decade, and there hasn't been a team in LA until now. And I guess you could say, well, the NFL wasn't here for 20 years, but still it's surprising. Why didn't this happen until now?
I mean, I'm ecstatic it didn't happen until now. I mean, I think, look, on the surface, and Kevin will support this, you know, LA is a really challenging market. I mean, we are walking into a sports environment where there are nine professional teams. You have USC and UCLA, which, you know, can be argued to be a professional, you know, organization. And if that wasn't enough competition for one's weekend time, you have the movies, you have music, you have the beach, you have the mountains. I mean, there's a lot of things to draw the attention away from people here in Los Angeles. So in order to grab that attention, you know, you have to build an organization of champions. And we think about that as being champions both on the field and off the field. So obviously creating an experience to show, you know, extreme experience showing up at the game that is unrivaled, to the play on the pitch being exceptional, to how we support our community. And, you know, we believe that we have a vision and a mission and a path to do that, where we can engage locally and entertain globally, that is unique, that leverages, you know, the entertainment capital of the world, and then also leverages our incredible founding investor group to help draw attention and awareness to this league and to these players that are unarguably the best in the world, creating sort of the best competition here in in the United States. And we hope to bring it to Los Angeles, and know that, you know, I'm a huge fan of the USC Trojans. I'm a huge fan of the Raiders. You know, sorry, the Rams. Sorry, Kevin. But
okay. I
support multiple clubs here in LA. And, you know, we think that we can, you know, draw a large, you know, soccer fan base. We know there are, a number of soccer fans here in their support of LAFC and the Galaxy, with consistently selling out their stadiums year in and year out, and being the only women's professional sports team here, bringing the best players in the world. Like, we think that we have a recipe for success here.
Well, Kevin, just weigh in on that. I mean, the uniqueness about the LA market, having nine teams here, and a lot of people, when you go to a sports bar on Sunday, are, you know, rooting for their team where they're from. Like me, I'm from Seattle, so I'm sorry. But, you know, it's a tough market, and also, you're competing in a sense for those PSLs for the new stadium and for sponsorships against the Dodgers, Clippers, and so many other teams. So talk about the uniqueness of the LA market.
Yeah. And I mean, I think, Julie, you know, if you add in Orange County, right, you're talking, there are five major league sports right now, men's sports. We have two teams in each of them, right? That's 10. You add in, you know, Julie's team, you add in the Sparks, you're now at 12, and then you still have UCLA, USC, and everything else Julie said. And I think the one interesting thing about this market is also that, you know, and I think this is where we get excited. This is not a market that builds new stadiums, right? I mean, it loves sports, it's passionate, but Dodger Stadium is the third oldest baseball stadium. Angel Stadium is the fourth oldest baseball stadium. Then you look at Staples Center, which we all think of as new, and it's 20 years old, right? And you think of the number of buildings that have been built in that time. Obviously the Galaxy, you know, I still call it StubHub Center, Dignity Health, you know, is there, you know, and is now 10 years old, 15 years old. You know, Banc of California Stadium is an amazing stadium, is 3 years old, you know, but we don't build new stadiums. And so I think that there's this, you know, and I think that always puts sports in perspective in Los Angeles, whereas you go to a place like New York, the only equivalent city when you talk about number of teams, and they've built six new stadiums or arenas in the past decade, and they're building a seventh now on Long Island. And I just think when you look at that juxtaposition, it shows you where LA is in the sports landscape. And I always think one of the hard things, and you know, it's amazing to have a market of roughly 20 million people to be able to go and to pitch to for fans and engagement and excitement. But where the challenges lie is, you know, Julie and I may be native Angelinos who grew up here in our sports, but half the population, and I'm estimating, is roughly from somewhere else, like you, Ben, right? So on Sundays, you're a Seahawks fan, right? Like, you may love LA, but LA is not a city that, you know, by nature comes together just because of sports teams. Sports teams bring LA together in the most meaningful and impactful ways. And I think back to our Monday night game against the Kansas City Chiefs after the fires and the borderline shooting and being full in the emotional moment. And the city comes together around that. But, you know, it is a different city. The fact that people come from different places, they still root for their favorite teams. And if you look at the NFL in particular, one of the things I always say is, you know, we were gone for 22 years, essentially. In that time, plenty of people moved to Southern California and stuck with the teams that they had because there was no NFL team here. And then there's a whole generation of kids who were born here, who were raised watching football on TV, who didn't have an affiliation. And we were, you know, so fortunate. I mean, people forget, we were the first professional sports team in Los Angeles when the team moved in 1946 and have a 55-year history. And so we can tap into those people who went to the Coliseum in the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, and Anaheim Stadium in the 80s and 90s. But when we come back, it's fair game. You're not just competing with us against the Chargers or the other 10 teams in the marketplace. You're competing with the 31 other teams. And when you look, and I think that's one of the unique things about Los Angeles is, yeah, you're just as likely to see a Yankees hat and a Cubs hat, you know, for baseball or, you know, other, I think the Lakers have a stronghold NBA wise, just a little bit more of the nature of that game. And that's why I think it's so exciting to see what someone like Julie's doing to go grow, because people don't have a women's soccer affiliation, right? They may root for U.S. soccer, but, you know, whatever your team is going to be named, TBD, Angel City FC, you know, that's an exciting new opportunity. For everybody else, you're competing with childhood loyalties. And that's where, you know, Ben, my hope is maybe your kids say, hey, I know my parents are Seahawks fans, but, you know, I want to be a Rams fan because I love going to SoFi Stadium. It's cool. And I love watching Aaron Donald. You know, it's a fight for that next generation, but it is a competitive marketplace, no doubt about it. And it's one, I think, where all the teams get along and come together in meaningful ways. You saw the Alliance get announced last month, a social justice effort committing $1 million a year from teams. But at the same time, like, there's only so much sponsorship dollars and fan discretionary dollars. And that's only going to be more limited, even in a post-COVID era. So, you know, it is competitive.
Yeah. Well, Julie, you know, I'm curious, you know, everyone is very excited about pro women's soccer in LA. Everyone wants to see players paid more. Right now, I believe the minimum salary is $20,000. The maximum is $50,000. As the person in charge of making the business work, and you've run a lot of other successful businesses, can you talk a little bit about how you plan to grow the revenue so that you guys can start paying players more?
I mean, I know there's a commitment from all the owners to want to address this and to try to bring more dollars into the players. We also support their housing and their auto. So there's more to the compensation than just the pure salary. Having said that, we do have to work within the salary cap. And what my team is thinking about are innovative ways to drive dollars to the players beyond just compensation. So how do we make them part of our organization and the way that we think about building the organization, the way we think about building our community, and the way we think about putting products and services out there that benefit the organization, but are really leveraging the talent of the players to do that. So whether it's participating in our upside revenue in certain different revenue streams, or instead of sort of requiring them to do things on our behalf, but really paying them to do things on our behalf, those are the types of things we're starting to think about. And we're also trying to think holistically about it from an entire league perspective so that we can do something in LA that the other teams can also emulate as well.
And any thoughts about the venue, or can you at least tell us what you are looking for?
I mean, yeah, we're looking for a world-class professional venue. We are in conversations as we speak and have been, and we'll announce before the end of the year where we're playing.
I know of one.
Yeah, I think you guys could use a third team at SoFi. You can fill 80,000, right?
Yes.
I bet they could.
Yeah. And This deal you guys signed with CBS as well as Twitch is interesting. How do you see, is Twitch only for international, or is that going to be available domestically as well?
Yeah, it's available for international games. It also does all of our replays, and I think they have some local market games as well. I mean, it's really exciting to have a multi-year partnership with a network and a product, you know, a sports product like CBS. They just picked up UEFA as well. So they're definitely leaning into soccer, which is really exciting to see. I mean, Twitch definitely targets more of the millennial Gen Z audience. And as we want to grow the visibility for, you know, the NWSL, it's a great audience to target. There's a lot of engagement on that platform. And I think a lot that we can do around shoulder content and branded content and programming to support the game and promote our team as well. So we're really excited about Twitch as a partner.
Well, you know, the power of the NFL on TV is just amazing. I don't think people realize just how successful it is. Last year, of the top 50 most viewed TV shows, 47 of them were NFL games. When so much of linear TV is plummeting, the NFL ratings continue to go up. But attendance last year hit a 15-year low. Rams attendance fell about 0.5%. So Kevin, you know, as we talk about building this beautiful new stadium, how big of a concern is that? Are you concerned, or, you know, are you making so much money from TV? It's not really a concern.
No, look, I think attendance is the lifeblood of any well-functioning organization, right? And people don't like I think we see it right now. When you turn on TV and watch baseball without fans there, it just seems different, right? And I think it's one thing when you come to accept that when there are no fans, but when you turn on a sporting event, you want it to be packed. You want the fans to be in it. And the best live television is driven by full attendance in buildings. Now, we're fortunate. You mentioned last year, the reason our attendance went down 0.5% is because we lost 4% of capacity at the Coliseum renovation. So our attendance was actually up year over year, which you hope it would be coming off of a Super Bowl appearance. And since we've been back to Los Angeles, we've averaged over 70,000 fans a game, which is what our attendance is in SoFi. So, you know, we feel really good about that. But I think long-term, you know, it's like everything else people talk about in, you know, COVID pandemic era, you know, every trend is being fast-forwarded 5 years, you know, or so right now. And I think you're getting to the more selective trend of how long will season tickets be something that people purchase now that it's easier to buy individual tickets and go to Ticketmaster or StubHub or SeatGeek or any website and get individual games. You know, as we make it easier to transact, to go to events, will people still want season tickets? Will they want the same seats night in and night out? You know, if you talk about baseball, do you want 81 games? Do you want 41, 42 for basketball and hockey? I think the NFL is still in a very enviable position of our games are scarce. We have 8 regular season games, 1 or 2 preseason games. All games mean something. And I think that is one of the great trends. But attendance has been declining in the NFL for a few years, along with every other sport, as we make the at-home experience better. And I think the trend you're going to see, and, you know, Julie and I have talked about this, if I were building a stadium anywhere but Los Angeles, I would be building smaller, more intimate, more customized, and more luxurious than anywhere else. Now, in Los Angeles, we can do all of those things in a 70,000 attendance venue just because we're in one of the greatest cities in the world and we're trying to host the world's greatest events. But I do think you're going to see over time buildings start to right size, you know, for this environment. And I think you're going to see that time and time again. Will that happen in Southern California? Time will tell. I don't see the Dodgers or, you know, the Angels are going to redo their stadium. Staples Center is about to undergo a major renovation. We'll see what changes they come up with. But, you know, I think everybody every year is going to be laser focused on attendance. And I think what's going to happen in the post-COVID era, the health, the safety, the food preparation, all of those little details that we knew were coming over time are going to be paramount of fans' mind. And the organizations that deliver upon them best are going to be the ones that see their attendance return to pre-COVID levels.
But, you know, the NFL is almost a victim of its success in this regard because the TV product has become so good. And a lot of people love watching Red Zone, and just the cameras and the replays are so good now that I think you can argue that, you know, staying at home is arguably a better experience than going to the stadium. So how do you compete against that by providing a superior in-stadium experience?
Well, I think there are two things to that. One, that is true to some degree, but there's still something about going to live events and live sporting events and the magic of them that being in person with 70,000, 75,000 people when you're allowed again is unique. And I mentioned, you know, our Monday night game against the Chiefs. I've heard from so many people it was one of the greatest sporting events of our life. I remember when we played, you know, the Cowboys in the playoff game, you know, to advance to the NFC Championship, 75,000 people on their feet the whole game, and just the sheer noise, the return to Southern California, 92,000 people, you know, at the Coliseum. Those events are memories forever. And, you know, people don't ever say, I remember where I was sitting on my couch when Kirk Gibson homered to win the World Series, you know, or, you know, where they were for Kobe's final game. They talk about their experiences in stadium. Now, that being said, we designed a stadium, you know, to meet those challenges, right? We have a 4K, 70,000 square foot, double-sided video board, which is the largest video board in the world and has technology better than you can buy in your own home, right? So we can show you every game that's going on at the same time. We can play Red Zone throughout the game, so you can both be at our game and watch Red Zone. You can come at 10 a.m. 3 hours before kick and watch every other game that's going on at the NFL and make it, you know, the world's best, you know, sporting bar environment, you know, in Los Angeles. You have to meet those challenges. We have 30 embedded cameras into our stadium, so you have better replay angles in our building than you can get at home. And even talking to the people at NBC who are going to do our opener, they're thrilled with the cameras that we have because it's more cameras than they would normally put, you know, at a game, the angles. So I think buildings are going to have to meet that challenge. We're one of the first fully 5G buildings, you know, in America. Our technology was designed to last 10 years. We have 5X basically the bandwidth of any stadium that's ever been built in terms of Wi-Fi. So I think you have to bring that experience to people. So when they're at the stadium, they don't feel like they're making any trade-offs in the way they operate on social media and the way they follow other games and interact, but you give them that chance to turn around and high-five the random stranger, you know, after a Robert Woods touchdown. And I think, you know, those great moments in sports history and LA history, people want to be together.
And it's interesting, you said something the other day that SoFi Stadium is actually the first NFL stadium we've had in LA. And I think a lot of people here have, you know, they've gone to football games, but they've never gone to a proper NFL stadium.
No, I mean, look, Seattle has one of the best experiences, you know, and I bet many of our fans have never been there. And I remember, you know, when we came back, people always said, well, why can't you just play in the Coliseum? And then, you know, the first game back, we ran out of water in the toilets didn't work. And people were like, no wonder the NFL left the Coliseum in 1993. It's the same building. And I think, you know, they did a wonderful job with their renovations last year. And people started to get that sense. The Rose Bowl, when they added their suite level. But it's just a fundamentally different experience. And I remember when USC played Alabama a couple years ago at AT&T Stadium in Dallas, and a bunch of USC alums went and they came back and they're like, is your stadium going to be like Dallas? I'm like, it'll be better than Dallas. And I'm like, okay, now we get it. And I think for those of us who have had the chance to walk the building in the past month as it comes to completion, it's an unbelievable venue that I think will blow people away. And I think it gets back to the original point. LA doesn't do stadiums. We have so many other great options that when people come to sporting events, they tolerate being in buildings that are 50 and 60 and 100 years old, like the Coliseum. And I think it's, you know, Bank of California Stadium really was a game changer, I think, in the way people looked at soccer. And I think our stadium will change the way people look at all sporting venues, not only here in LA, but in the world.
And we did have a question from our audience about, you know, how you plan to present games this year with fans not in the stands. It's worked pretty well, I think, better than people expected for Major League Baseball and the NBA. But any sense of how that will look for the NFL?
Yeah, I mean, look, I think the one thing, you know, certainly all year, we're going to have tarps on the first eight rows to protect the players so that if there are fans at some point, you know, their interaction will be limited, right? So it will be similar to what you've seen some of the other sports, you know, with advertising on tarps. I think if anybody has watched the English Premier League restart, I think that's probably the best facsimile as to what I can imagine the NFL coming back. You have the tarps around the field. You know, whether we put cardboard cutouts of fans, Ben, you were privy to that conversation right before we jumped on this Zoom. We're having that, you know, and I think it's going to be up to the broadcasters. What do they do if there are no fans in the stadium? Can they put cameras in different places than they ever have before? I think you're seeing that in the NBA right now. They're experimenting with different camera angles because you're not blocking fans, right? Normally, among the biggest complaints we always get each year from our season ticket holders was, you know, the cameraman was blocking my view for half the game, or the cart on the sidelines was in my way. Well, that's going to be gone now, right? So can you put, you know, a camera eight levels up? You know, can you move where Skycam goes? I think it's really going to be up to our broadcast partners to figure out how you determine that. You know, the NFL, how you do crowd noise in stadiums so that it's got a little bit more authentic atmosphere for both the players and for the fans at home. I think all of those are going to be interesting elements. And my hunch is what you see week one against the Cowboys may be very different than what you see, you know, week 12 or 13 against the Patriots.
Julie, how do you see, I mean, for your sport, you know, in person versus Twitch and CBS and all other media, how do you see that shaking out, especially over the next decade?
Like, I think any sport that's growing, having fans in attendance in games is really important, right? Your off-field experience a lot of times is dictated by the on-field experience, right? By seeing the fans and hearing the fans. So I think it's really important for us to build our fan base. We know that NWSL games can sell out. We know that you can get north of 20,000 fans per game. Portland has done it consistently in 2019. You know, that's our bogey here. We want to do the same. We know the U.S. women's team, national team, can do even more than that. And we've seen examples in England where Wembley Stadium has sold out for women's teams. So we know that there's an audience and a fan base. As Kevin said, there is something really unique and special about being in stadium and feeling that community. And I think soccer, and specifically what LAFC has done with the 3252, they have created just this incredible experience where you feel part of something. You feel a sense of belonging when you go to an LAFC game. My first game was last year. And I mean, like I said, I'm a season ticket for the USC Trojans. I've gone to nearly every single game since I was 7, 8, 9 years old. And it was a fundamentally different experience that I didn't even really knew existed. And I think that that's something that we can provide. And there's so much enthusiasm and excitement for these players and knowing they're the best in the world. We want to get them in stadium. We have some more time. Thankfully, we don't take the pitch until April of 2022. So obviously we'll be watching closely how we start to control COVID and put in the necessary health and safety precautions. But we have a little bit more time and hopefully get our stadium full by our opening match.
Was that always the plan to start in 2022?
We started the conversations regarding bringing a team to LA in August of last year, so literally a year away. We did think early about launching in 2021, predominantly because of the proximity to the Olympics. We thought the Olympics and coming off a victory at the World Cup and then hopefully a victory during the Olympics would be an incredible springboard to announce the club and draw excitement and bring players that hopefully were part of the national team to LA, and just thought from an awareness story, it would be pretty incredible. Obviously, we very quickly thought that that might not be the right decision. And we actually worked very closely with the league in determining when it was the right time for the league to come in. And then from a building perspective, what is the appropriate amount of time to actually build a sports club? 15 months is certainly not it, but it's definitely better than 9 months. And it gives us a lot more time to be thoughtful about the right way to approach the community, as well as sort of address the health and safety concerns that we're seeing today.
And how big do you see the league getting? How many cities do you think can support professional women's soccer?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of that comes down to the player base, and the player base continues to grow. And especially as we start thinking about players from a global lens and not just a US-centric lens. When we join the league in 2022, we'll be the 11th team to join the league. You know, I think today there's an understanding that the league can probably support 14 teams, maybe up to 16 teams in the next 5 to 10 years. As we continue to start building youth and work on a actual development program for the NWSL. So those are some things that I know that the owners and the commissioner are thinking about today, but I think it can get at least to 14 in the short term and maybe a little bit longer, bigger than that in the longer term.
Well, Kevin, you guys, the NFL rights are up in 2022. Obviously all the existing partners want to pay a lot more to keep their packages, but do you see that one of the big tech companies with a lot of cash sitting around like Amazon, Apple, or Netflix could step in and take a part of that package? Amazon has stepped a toe in, but in terms of a big exclusive rights package, do you see that happening?
It'll be interesting whether that happens in 2022. I think in all sports, people are waiting for those companies to jump in and figure out how to make that part of their atmosphere. And I think if you look at Amazon in particular, they started with the English Premier League this year, broadcasting games in the UK. And, you know, people have wondered if that's given them a greater appetite. The success of that, which has gone very well, has given them a greater appetite to expand. You know, obviously, you know, as the worlds between traditional network television and content providers of all sorts blends, just as Julie says, whether it's Twitch, you know, or anybody else, you know, I think that day is coming. I just don't think any of us know when it is. And it's ultimately going to be, you know, what compels someone to jump in. You know, the NFL has had a partnership with Amazon around Thursday night the past few years. You know, we've worked with Yahoo on an international game. You know, Twitter has been a partner for Thursday night and for different games. And so I think everybody has dipped their toe in, right? Does, you know, now especially, I think you're seeing, you know, but one of the, I think the interesting shifts has also been as everybody talks about the Amazons and the Apples and the Netflix and what they are at, you know, Disney went and created ESPN Plus. They're looking for content for that. You look at NBC Universal, which just created Peacock. They need, in, you know, programming for that, CBS All Access. Everybody is coming up with these OTT products, I think, and, you know, web-only versions of which they want live sports as well. If you think about Peacock, they launched essentially with four English Premier League games and for free on Peacock, using live sports to help drive that. And, if, you know, for those us Arsenal fans who watched them win the FA Cup this past Saturday, that was on ESPN Plus and nowhere else. And so I think, you know, the traditional networks, as they continue to grow their OTT and their direct to consumer, they're using sports as that platform. And there's so much money going to that space that I think you're going to continue to see that. And, you know, whether it's the DirecTVs and ATT, whether they want to keep, you know, the NFL Sunday ticket package, whether that becomes more a la carte. I've always wondered when you're going to see the day when you can go onto iTunes and buy, if you live in, you know, Topeka, can you buy Rams versus 49ers? If you grew up in LA, a Rams fan, you now live in Kansas, can you go onto iTunes and pay $6.99 just to watch Rams 49ers? Is that day coming? Is that 10 years away? Is that 5 years away? You know, is it never, right? You know, I think the one interesting thing for the NFL, and this is the push-pull, is the growth of the sport has always been that it's been on free TV and widely distributed. Right. And really, even the games that are on cable, when you look at Monday Night Football, still are shown on free over the air TV in the markets. That's been what the league has always been baked upon. You know, what premium would you have to get to change some of that model? Can you, you know, be certain that these companies can deliver, you know, a great product? Obviously, they've been so innovative everywhere else. Or does it sit alongside, you know, that element? But you see now, you know, the NFL's partnership with Verizon, where you can watch games, you know, on your phone, you know, throughout the marketplace. I think the NFL is going to continue to experiment. You know, who knows what this round of talks will be. But I also, you know, in a post-COVID environment, when you've seen the valuations of all of those companies continue to grow and touch record highs, you know, how did they put that money to use?
Yeah, it's a great time to be renegotiating those rights. But it is interesting to think, I mean, because the NFL already has the NFL Network, which shows some games, a few exclusively. But, you know, at what point would they say, we don't need broadcast partners, we're just going to do direct to consumer like, you know, UFC does?
You know, look, I think that ultimately comes back to the popularity of the NFL. And when you talk about 47 of the top 50 shows being, you know, NFL games, you know, is there a reason to break that mold, you know, when that's by far the greatest distribution vehicle that you can have? And I think one of the reasons you see the NFL be that way is, quite frankly, all of our games are on over-the-air television. So when you look at the highest rated games in maybe other leagues, they may be on cable, right? You have some leagues that have their championships, you know, on ESPN or on TNT. You look at the playoffs, whereas on the NFL, those live on the broadcast networks. And I think there is a magic in that for the NFL that always has been. And, you know, someday when you're a five-year-old kid who loves the Rams and want to watch, you may get the sense that I'm going to go log on to my phone. You know, all of our kids have phones probably by five and in 10 years. You know, Are they going to know how to do that? Or is it just gather around the television and watch these games, you know, on air? Is it OTT? I do think there is magic in broadcast television, just like I think there is magic in the in-person experience. And the more you try to get away from that, I think will happen over time, and it may be small shifts, but I don't know right now that the world is ready for the NFL to leave, you know, the CBS, Fox, NBC, ABC model.
But, you know, it used to be that, you know, Sunday was NFL day and then there was Monday Night Football. Now, you know, the best package is usually Sunday night. There's a big package for Thursday night. There's talk of possible Tuesday night. At what point do you think that it loses some of the specialness and it becomes a bit saturated?
Look, I think that's the specialness is always about the product, right? If we continue to put compelling, great games on television, whether it's Thursday night, Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night's a new one to me. I guess I should read, you know, up on today's social media if that's in the discussions. But look, first and foremost, if we can play a full schedule, you know, with player health and safety in mind, and the quality of games is up to fan expectations, I think people will come where you build it. And people thought that Thursday night would have oversaturation, and it just hasn't been, you know, the case. Sunday night's an amazing night of football. You know, and I remember when we grew up, that package was on TNT, you know, at first glance. You see what Monday Night Football has become, you know, and I remember vividly, you know, when we, and I've referenced this game, but our Chiefs, you know, Rams game was the highest rated Monday Night game in years and reminded people of the magic, you know, of Monday Night. Now, we also scored 106 points and it was an amazing game, but I think it's still about the product on the field. And as broadcasters innovate, and as the players get better, you know, and you see these young stars, Patrick Mahomes and Deshaun Watson, Lamar Jackson, you know, Aaron Donald, not as young anymore. It's a great game to watch. And, you know, and I do think, you know, with the continued evolution and attitudes around, you know, daily fantasy, legalized sports betting, you know, that interest is only going to grow.
Yeah, I was going to ask about legalized sports betting and also open it up to you, Julie, just since you've also worked in a lot of media. But what do you think when you look at like the NFL rights picture and sort of that being like the last thing that's holding linear TV together? Julie, I think you're muted.
Oh, sorry. My son distracted me. You got to love live Zoom calls. Yes. No, look, I have recently become obsessed with Formula One. Thank you, Netflix, for their two docuseries. But I feel like I know more about that sport maybe than any other sport, including football, which I grew up with. And I now play in a fantasy league, and it just makes it more fun. And so to Kevin's point, I do think that the growth in fantasy and legalized gaming will have actually a positive impact on sports and bring more attention to it. And also, you know, in some respects, really help you understand how incredibly exceptional these professional athletes are, right? You start to look at things outside of just, you know, have they caught a ball or how far they run, but really their athleticism and how smart they are and how they think about the game. And so I think all, you know, look, technology is moving forward. We have to embrace that. We have to know that, but what's the right way to utilize it and how to use it as a way to bring people together and to continue to create a sense of community and belonging, I think is the challenge. And I think if we're all focused on that, it can only be beneficial.
Yeah, so since the U.S. Supreme Court overturned the federal ban on sports betting in 2018, 20 states have legalized it. California hasn't yet, but it's definitely moving in that direction. NBA Commissioner Adam Silver has said the amount of money bet on sports could be up to $400 billion per year. So, Kevin, how do you see that? I mean, it seems like fantasy has been so great for getting people to still watch a game, even if it's a blowout in the fourth quarter, because they want to see, you know, their fantasy player. How do you see legalized sports betting changing the outlook over the next decade?
Well, I think Julie just mentioned it, and she used a Formula One example, which may be extreme, right? But, you know, legalized sports betting, and to some degree, you know, fantasy, it turns the casual fan into an avid fan, right? It changes the dynamic. It also changes how you share it. For people who are in a fantasy league, you know, there's a great, you know, social network that's created by that. It brings office places together. It brings communities together. And I think, you know, the more people can engage, and I've always said, I don't know that you're going to see, you know, as much of the hardcore you know, is it, you know, I'm going to bet on this Formula One team versus this and that, but, you know, can you get to the point, you know, and I think the game change will be, you know, will Jared Goff pass for 250 yards, you know, the same way people play fantasy, you know, and Julie talks about Wembley. I went to a friendly England-Belgium in soccer in 2012 at Wembley Stadium, and I knew nothing about either team. But here I am in the 83rd minute. I had Belgium to have more than 7 corner kicks, and they were like 5. So I'm screaming for penalties to get to 7 corner kicks, right? And I think that's one of the game changers that you start to see in what a legalized sports betting community be. A, it keeps you engaged in the whole game, depending on what happens. It forces you to learn new players, new teams, new atmospheres. And I think it teaches you to better understand the game. And I think all of those things take that person who's a casual fan, one of those, you know, if you're taking in the NFL, one of those people who watches the top 47 out of 50 and makes them really want to watch a team. Now, I do think there's danger as well, right? The kids growing up today may care more about their fantasy teams than they care about any individual team, right? I mean, and I think, you know, one of the great things for the Rams and the Sean McVay is we score a lot of points. You know, Todd Gurley and Jared Goff and, you know, Robert Woods and Cooper Kupp have been great fantasy players, you know, every year. You know, the year Todd Gurley won MVP, you know, offensive MVP in 2017, he single-handedly won people the fantasy playoffs in that 3-game stretch, including against your beloved Seahawks up there in Seattle, right? And so I think that changes people's opinion. People want to buy jerseys. They want to become fans. It's, I think, a great way to dip your toe in. And I think all sports are going to get there. And will we see legalized sports betting over time in all states? I think we will, just because, you know, especially post-COVID, how you build up, you know, revenue again in all these states, people are going to look to any avenue they can. And I think legalized sports betting is going to be one of them.
And is that something that you're planning for in the stadium? I mean, your owner has experience with that overseas and in England.
Yeah, no, I think, look, one of the great things about designing our stadium, we talk about future-proofing it. You know, our stadium's 3.2 million square feet. It is the largest sports stadium in the world. And I think, you know, to put that in comparison, it's roughly almost double the square footage of Levi's Stadium, you know, up in Santa Clara, which is an amazing building itself. But when you have that, you have space to play, you know, with different concepts in different areas. And we have a space always on level 4 in our building, which in my mind has always been a long-term fantasy zone, sports book, gathering spot. It's currently a team store and a bar and a gathering place right now. But if legalized sports betting were to come to stadiums, then I absolutely think you could see us transform that into a different type place. And it could be, you know, we're fortunate that between us and the Chargers, there'll be game there every Sunday, but could you open that up, you know, on a Monday night and show, you know, a game on the Oculus, 70,000 square feet, and have that sports book and be a 365 day a year experience? Because that changed the foot traffic into some of these stadiums, and so many stadiums and areas are now mixed use districts. Are you going to see all these, you know, whether it's LA Live or Hollywood Park, you know, or any other mixed use district, are you going to start to see sports gaming establishments come in and become part of that and attract millennials and different people? I absolutely think that that's probably in the next 10 years, that will become fairly commonplace the way we see it in England.
Yeah, you have Hollywood Park Casino right on the premises there.
It is amazing. You know, we always used to think that having a card club at the edge of our property might be a negative. As legalized sports gaming has come into play, who knows? It could be a positive. It could be, you know, the exact same, you know, the way it is. And it's a great place to visit if people haven't been there. We don't even want to give it a plug.
No, it's very nice, although closed right now. So, Julie, you know, it's a little bit challenging to think about where you guys would have a stadium because LA is so spread out. Any thoughts about, like, geographically where the best place would be or what you're looking for in terms of that?
I mean, yeah, we're looking at where we can create the best fan experience, what's convenient from public transportation perspective, what can draw from multiple different cities and counties within Los Angeles. We look at traffic patterns, we look at time of day, we look at time of week. I mean, it's all the things that you would probably expect and imagine. But at the end of the day, we want to bring, you know, an exceptional team to LA, and we want to build an incredible experience for our fans. And so we have to look at all of these factors to do that.
And how involved are these very famous owners that you have, you know, Serena Williams, Natalie Portman, a host of others? Are they going to be involved in helping you build the team? And are they going to be sort of, you know, are we going to see them in the stands once the games start?
Oh, you'll absolutely see them in the stands. And they're very involved. I mean, we set out to find partners, not investors. You know, they believe that mission and capital can coexist. They believe that we can make an impact locally in our community while we try to entertain globally and build a brand and use this platform of Angel City to at first bring, you know, an incredible women's professional soccer team to Los Angeles. But, you know, we have bigger ambitions than just that. But every single founding investor has something really unique to offer, whether it's their own set of skills and experiences or their network of people they can bring to the table. So as celebrities start introducing us to their brand partners, as athletes start talking to us about a short list of folks that we should look at from a sporting director standpoint or a coaching standpoint, I mean, every single person adds real value to the organization. They've all raised their hand to help. It's actually on me to make the phone calls and reach out to them because they're waiting to hear from me.
What are some tips that you've gotten so far, some ideas?
To be thoughtful about our growth, obviously to make sure that we take the time and intention to really build our community and our supporters group, which is absolutely what we're focused on initially. Not to rush. We really don't need to figure out the soccer operations side of the house until next year. So let's build the foundation first, and then we can focus on that next year. But it's always been like, you know, all the advice has been really incredible. I mean, this is a new team of owners. There's not a lot of sports experience. There's a lot of entertainment experience, and they're athletes, and we have incredible entertainment execs between Brian Weinstein and Cindy Holland. And so we have the foundation to tell the stories that we want to tell and to bring storytelling and the narratives of the league and the players and the fans of the community to LA. We have the business expertise to make sure that we build the foundation in the right way. And we have the soccer expertise to make sure that we build the right, you know, product on the field.
I love the fact that multiple owners is great when you're starting up, but they bring the expertise. Wait until that first tough loss and see, you know, multiple disappointed owners. They, you know, one disappointed owner is hard enough. I can't imagine multiple disappointed owners.
Yeah, it's a good point. Well, we'll just require winning and then it won't be a problem. Easy. Super simple.
Piece of cake. Well, I was going to ask about that. I mean, you guys are both from LA, but Kevin, you spent most of your career with the Rams in that other city. And obviously LA is a much bigger market, so it's very different. But what is, and you knew that, but what has surprised you most about, you know, running the team here as opposed to St. Louis?
You know, I think the one thing you love is this is a terrific football market, but still just the how hard it is to continue to build and to grow. I mean, we're unbelievable in the sense that, you know, we've been in the top 10 in the attendance in the NFL and grow, but I always feel like there are parts of Southern California that we could spend a year in untapped, you know, and get to spend more time in the Inland Empire, get to spend more time in Orange County and just how large it is, and just the fervor and passion, you know, for the NFL that exists, you know, overall. I mean, we have seen it time and time again, and I love seeing it. But I also, you know, to your point, it is, there are a ton of visiting fans. I remember when we played the Bills in 2016 and, you know, 10,000 Bills fans showed up to tailgate. You know, this is a city, you know, that has been built on everybody coming and loving their places, and people bring their passions, and it's hard. You know, I always tell the great story. One of my really good friends, who's a season ticket holder, you know, asked for field passes for the Bears game last year. And I'm walking by the sideline and there's his entire family in Bears gear, except his son who was wearing a Rams jersey, you know, and this is one of my really good friends who has season tickets, who's still a Bears fan from growing up in Chicago. Right. And I just think, you know, it is a laborious process to build and keep building a brand and continue to win each and every time. And we've been so excited and so wonderful to see the reception, to see people buy seats in the new stadium. But I do think the one thing is it is still a large city with people having emotional ties to so many places. And, you know, that 22 years of, despite having 50 years of history before we walked back in, it's both a blessing and a curse to go restart that and to reimagine what NFL football, you know, can be. And we've loved every minute of it. And it's great to meet those fans and to hear the stories. There's nothing more heartwarming when you see, you go to a game and you see a you know, family wearing, you know, grandparent wearing a Roman Gabriel jersey, you know, and then the parent wearing an Eric Dickerson jersey and the child wearing an Aaron Donald jersey, right? Like, sports is passed down generationally, and I don't think that that will ever change, you know? And so it's great to see, but even, you know, now, you know, as you start to go out, you know, towards the end of the pandemic, you come out and see people in Rams gear, it reminds people, like, oh, the season's coming, and it gets people excited again. But this is a huge, huge market, and just the effort it takes to cover every inch. I mean, one of our strategic points, and you asked Julie about their stadium, we knew our stadium was always going to be in Inglewood or the Coliseum. So we chose to put a practice facility in the Valley, which no one had ever done, to try to give the people of the Valley an ownership. And we did training camp in Orange County to give those of our fans in Orange County a sense of ownership. How do you try to give everybody a piece of ownership in a region that is so vast and so disparate? And how do you make it easy for people to come to your games? I think, you know, I am still amazed. My family used to ride the Metro to the games of the Coliseum, packed trains of Rams fans, you know, chanting whose house, Rams house, watching LA use public transportation. But how do we get that to SoFi Stadium? I think all the things that continue to amaze you about the way fans are evolving and will continue to evolve in this marketplace. It is not one, there's not a one size fits all, pull at the civic heartstrings of Los Angeles. It is a diverse, large market, and your brand has to reflect that every day.
Well, we're just about out of time, but I want to just end with a brief painting of the picture, if you will, of you guys, because I miss going to games so much. I miss sports. So when we eventually can go back to your respective stadium, Julie, wherever yours is, and Kevin, when we finally get to see SoFi Stadium in person, I just want you to paint a picture of what it will look like for fans when they're able to walk in. And Julie, can you start?
Yeah, because my answer is way less interesting than what Kevin's going to be. I mean, so yeah, it's April of 2022. You know, I hope you're walking into a stadium that is loud and rambunctious and everyone's wearing the same color, so you have this sense of belonging, and it's sold out. Like, there's not an empty seat in the house. And there's a lot of enthusiasm and excitement for the players, but also this incredible sense of belonging and community that we built this together. I mean, we did not say, hey, we are bringing a team, or we bought a team, and we're dropping it here, right? We are trying to build something special together with our community and with our fan base. And so hoping that we can help them have a sense of ownership and belonging and create an emotional connection with our team is our ultimate goal.
Yeah, so I'm going to take a stab at this. You know, it's going to start with driving down Manchester or Prairie and not being able to see this amazing stadium. And then you make the turn and this architectural marvel pops up out of nowhere because it's low slung, 150 feet out of the ground. We've all seen it from the air, but so few people have been up. And then you park your car and you go in through our landscaping, which has every tree native to California except for a redwood. And you go into this 2.5 acre large covered American Airlines Plaza. You walk into this completely open air, indoor, outdoor stadium. You go and get your local beer and your vegan taco. And as you go to your seat, you have a view of the ocean on one side and the Hollywood sign on the other. You have this unbelievable 4K scoreboard. And as you take your wide, comfortable seat, no matter where you are in the building, and you sit in one of the most vertically intimate buildings ever designed, our team comes out and takes the field and makes you feel proud to be an Angeleno, makes you feel proud to be a Rams fan, and you have an unbelievable experience. And I would say win or lose, but you're there in that new building, you know, for the first time Los Angeles has ever had a modern NFL stadium. You know, Stan Kroenke has transported you to the future of sports worldwide right here in our hometown. I think that's what I can't wait for people to experience.
Well, that sounds truly wonderful. I can't wait to go to both your stadiums. And as I know, we all can't wait to get there. So thank you so much for joining us. This was really interesting. And best of luck. Stay safe, stay healthy. And thanks so much for joining us.